Today we are exploring something cool, .NET Core Dependency Injection. Dependency Injection is a way to help your code components work together better. It's like making sure all the puzzle pieces fit without being stuck too tightly. By doing this, we make our code more like building blocks. If things are too stuck together, changing one part can mess up a lot of other things. Dependency Injection helps us avoid a mess, making our code easier to understand and fix. So let's dive into the world of dependency injection in .NET Core. In this demonstration, I'll be working with a .NET Core Web API project. To start, I'll create a folder called Services, where we'll store our service classes. Next, I'll go ahead and create a class within this new folder. I'll name it Random Number Service. Inside this class, I'm declaring an integer named random number, and we'll make it read-only. Now, in the class constructor, I'm creating an object of the random class. We'll use this object to assign a random number for our integer. To make things specific, I'll set the random number to be between 1 and 100. Moving on, I'm declaring a method named getNumber, which will give us the integer value. To keep it concise, I'll simplify it by changing it to an expression-bodied method. Now, let's incorporate this class as a service in the program.cs file. To achieve this, I'm utilizing the addSingleton method of the service collection to register it as a service. Let me take a moment to explain the various types of services available. In the realm of dependency injection, we commonly encounter three types of services: singleton, transient, and scoped. These terms essentially describe how objects managed by dependency injection containers behave and their lifecycle within the application. Shortly, we'll delve into each of these types along with a best practice to guide you. Before we move on, let's create a Web API controller in our project. I'll name it Test Controller. In the constructor of this controller, I'll be accepting the random number service as a parameter. Since we have injected the dependency, we can now receive the service object in the class constructor. Additionally, I'll declare a read-only object of the random number service class within the controller and then assign the received object to it. This ensures that we have access to our service throughout the controller. For demonstration purposes, let's create two different objects of the same service in our test controller. I'll name them RandomNumberService1 and RandomNumberService2. In the constructor, I'll make the necessary changes to assign both RandomNumberService1 and RandomNumberService2 from the received objects. This way, we'll have two separate instances of the RandomNumberService. Now, let's create an HTTP GET method within our test controller. This method will return an OK response along with both the numbers obtained from RandomNumberService1 and RandomNumberService2. To retrieve these values, we are utilizing the getNumber method provided by our RandomNumberService. Now let's run the project and observe how a singleton service operates. With Swagger enabled in our project, we can conveniently test the API method using it. Now let's execute the API method that we created. In the response body, you'll notice that both the numbers are the same. Repeated executions will demonstrate that the numbers remain unchanged. This behavior is a result of registering our service as a singleton. A singleton service is created once and reused for the entire lifetime of the application. The same instance is injected into every dependent class throughout the application. This makes it suitable for stateless services or services that hold shared state across the application. Now, in the program.cs class, let's change the service type to a scoped service. After making this change, let's run and execute the API method again. You'll notice that, just like before, both numbers are initially the same in the response body. However, on subsequent executions, you'll observe that the numbers are changing. Importantly, number 1 and number 2 consistently have the same value. This is because a scoped service is created once per request. It remains the same within a single request, but differs across different requests. The service is disposed of when the request is completed. This makes it suitable for services that need to maintain state across multiple operations within a single request. Now let's explore how a transient service functions. Upon executing the API method again, you'll observe that both number 1 and number 2 values are different this time. Subsequently, with each request, both numbers will undergo changes. This behavior is a result of a transient service, which is created each time it is requested. It is not reused and is disposed of after the request is completed. Transient services are suitable for lightweight, stateless services where a new instance is needed for every request or operation. Moving on, let's explore the concept of a service with interface implementation. When you compile a service with an interface, you essentially use the service throughout its interface. This practice promotes loose coupling, making it easier to replace or extend implementations without affecting the rest of the application. This adds flexibility to your code base and allows for easier maintenance and updates. To illustrate this concept, I'll add a new interface inside the services folder named iRandomNumberService. Since our service has only one method named getNumber, I'll declare this method in the interface. Now, I'll make our service inherit from this interface. In the program.cs class, I'll mention the interface in the method. This allows us to use the interface wherever we need. I'll proceed to update the controller to use the interface instead of the concrete service, showcasing how this implementation enhances flexibility and promotes loose coupling. Before moving forward, let's ensure the application is running smoothly by testing it again. As we execute the API method, we should observe that everything is functioning as expected, confirming that our recent changes have not impacted the overall functionality of the application. Let's consider a scenario where we need to change the service implementation, perhaps for testing purposes. I'll create a new class named RandomNumberServiceTest and inherit it from the interface. Implementing the interface will automatically generate the required method. For testing purposes, let's make this method return 1000. Now, instead of changing the reference to the RandomNumberServiceTest everywhere in the project, we can simply go to the program.cs class and replace the service class there. This way, the application will now use the new RandomNumberServiceTest service wherever the interface is referenced. Let's run a test. Upon executing the method, you'll observe that now we are now consistently getting 1000 as the values. Repeated executions will confirm that the value remains the same. Now, if we need to revert to the original service implementation, we can easily do so by changing it back in the program.cs class. Remember, these concepts empower you to build modular, flexible, and maintainable applications. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Happy coding, and see you in the next one. Thank you.